Now, this is what I talked about, Mrs. Thatcher. What we should have done is, according to the MRC, we weren't allowed to do near market research. We were supposed to hide it off to private industry because, by naturally being in the public sector, we were hopeless, you see, because we were lazy, lackadaisical, kind of very doctrinaire stuff at the time. That was all part of a move to privatise our labs. It was all happening about the same time, well, over a period of years. So we enlisted Richard Durban, who was a very skillful programmer, to write programs by which digitize the films and put them together in three dimensions, and then you could calculate a view from any direction. It was a very good program. And so we built completely the first working confocal microscope, and we tried to find a market for it. By then we were now doing, this was 1986. This was fairly early on, 86 or 87. In fact, it was before CAT. Zeiss didn't show any interest. There was Cambridge Instrument Company, which had built on, they'd built scanning electron microscopes, which were showed surface features. And they hummed and hawed. They said, well, we want to go into optics. And there was a company called Bio-Rad, which made medical supplies, and they supplied things for optical equipment and so on, you know, washing fluids, and they provided chemicals. And they wanted to get into medical or biomedical instrumentation. And in the end, they decided to back it. So we built completely the first one, and they built and then we really taught them how to build four identical copies. And this is where they came into their own, because they had a large company with a rather large sales force, and they took this confocal microscope to various labs. They went to Gary Borisey at Wisconsin, who was working on motility, and others, and simply left them there. And the programs that were written by Richard Durban were such that they very easy to use. They were really user-friendly. And Brad Amos went along and gave a couple of hours tutorial or something on the use of the programs. So within a year, the Bio-Rad thing swept. Well, it never started to sell very well. And then later on, this was just one color later. You know, the things were illuminated by, it was one wavelength, one color. But later, as other dyes were invented, you could have different colors, you could do multi-colors, you could do multi-labeling, multi-chemical labeling. And if you look at the components, and a paper published by Hugh Pelham in Science, was the cover of Science, on the endoplasmic reticulum. This is the first time anybody had seen the endoplasmic reticulum in glorious color, and followed in 3D. You could follow all its invaginations and ruffles and so on. So it was a great step forward. But the lab made quite a bit of money from this, and the MRC did. But now, the rule of one-third actually only applies to small amounts of money. As you get into bigger sums of money, and this applies to the antibodies, there's a sliding scale. So the inventors and the lab get less and less, and the MRC gets more and more. The idea being that I'm not against it at all, because you can't have very great inequalities in the lab. People can really perhaps double their income or something of that sort. It shouldn't be. So that's part of the awards to inventors.